Okay, so as said, my name is Lars Knoll, and I'll be here to talk a little bit about Qt today and tomorrow, where we are and where we'll be heading with the technology. So this is a bit more of a general talk, talking about Qt as a, you know, in general, what we're doing on all the platforms that we support. As you know, Qt is a cross-platform framework where we support desktop, embedded, mobile. And even though, you know, the seminar now today is mostly about embedded, you'll get a lot of that later on. I'll talk a bit about, you know, what we're doing in general with Qt. But before, you know, as the first thing, actually let's have a short look back into history. Because Qt actually turned, as a technology, turned 20 years this year. In May 20th, 1995, Trolltech, who owned the technology at that point in time and who created it, released the first version of Qt ever. And that was, you know, for X11 and Linux at that point in time. And I have to say, you know, we've come a long way, you know, during all these years. And I'm really proud of all that has happened with the technology, where we've started off and where we are today. So that's really fantastic, and I'm really, really happy about many of these things that have happened there. So, you know, if we look back at that and all the evolutions, then, you know, I have good hopes for the future, and we'll have a little bit of a look, you know, at what's going to happen now in the next, you know, let's say 5 to 20 years. But if we want to do that, we have to first think about, you know, what's actually the main reasons, why is Qt here as a technology? What are we doing? You know, why do we exist, and what's the purpose of Qt as a technology? And, you know, very simply put, Qt is there to enable you and as developers and the companies to go beyond today and create really the technology of tomorrow. Qt has always been there to help developers. We had always a focus on, you know, getting things done, you know, being pragmatic and have, you know, are a framework that really helps developers create applications and create devices. So, you know, for the past 20 years, we have been a leading framework for application development and UI creation. And companies have, you know, a wide variety of companies have been using Qt to create, you know, applications for their use cases and be able to satisfy, you know, their needs and the needs of their users using Qt. And as you know, I mean, things are changing faster and faster in the software industry, and we have want to follow up. We want to be able there, and we want to lead actually what's happening in the software industry. We want to make sure that also in the future, you can, using Qt, create the whatever user experiences you want to deliver to your users, whatever devices you want to create, whatever applications you want to do, you should be able to do those with Qt. This is really what we're trying to do. You know, make software developers' life easy and secure you also into the future. So, you know, from that, you know, big vision, as I would say it, you know, let's go a little bit more into details and see how do we actually achieve that. And there's a couple of things that we need to have in place for that. So let's have a look at some of them. The most important part is actually to have a, you know, the Qt story in place, and, you know, what are we creating to and for whom are we creating it. Qt is a, you know, widely adopted cross-platform toolkit where people are doing lots of different devices, you know, on the desktop side, from very big, you know, applications such as, for example, Maya or others, to, you know, vertical industries like the oil industry has been using us, up to small embedded devices where people are also using Qt to create their user experiences. So there's a wide variety of use cases, and Qt has always been and will always be this a horizontal offering that's very strong and where we want to provide you with all the means of all the things that you need to do to create your applications, to create your embedded device, to create your user experience. And we've been, you know, what Qt there is to what's important for us to there is to take all these different, you know, things that people want to do in different industries for completely different types of devices or applications and try to figure out what's common in between them and abstract that, distill that into an easy to use API. It's really about making, you know, 90% of the use cases of what you want to do with Qt trivial and make the remaining 10% as easy as possible. Another big part of the story is that Qt is independent. You know, we have a we're our own company. We're independent of any of the major, you know, or let's say really big players in the industry, and we have a very tight relationship to the open source world. Qt has always been released as open source, pretty much from the beginning. Not everything there, but most of it. And, you know, we want to continue that. So we want to provide a technology that gives developers and companies the freedom to innovate on, you know, our platform, on our technology, and without locking them into, you know, a single platform or a single framework, single operating system, or a single vendor. And a big part of that is also that we are, as I said, you know, we are open source, we are using the open source community, the ecosystem, and we're actually welcoming also contributions to Qt from the people that are using Qt. So everybody is welcome to, you know, bring their feature back into the product, something they need. So if you have a need, you know, you can help us, we can help you develop that feature, get it back into the framework, if that's where the right place for it is. Or you can work with us on that and be able to contribute it yourself. As a third piece, we also want to enable that kind of freedom, you know, from a technical perspective. We want to be on top of the latest technologies and give you as a developer the freedom to basically choose what kind of technologies you are using in addition to Qt. Use and integrate with the latest technologies, like things that are currently happening in the 3D space where, you know, Vulkan is being discussed as a successor to OpenGL. Make sure that we support the latest releases of all operating systems, whether they're desktop, mobile, or embedded. And, you know, be on all these platforms so that you have the freedom to choose which platform you operating system you want to use and support. And, you know, we don't really want to limit anybody's innovation, but rather enable it. You know, make sure that you can innovate using Qt and create your own innovative solutions on it. And finally, Esmin, we also want to be, you know, there and figure out how the future is built. We want to be part of basically changing how things are being done in the future and molding that into something that, you know, really makes developers' lives easy. Said that is one of our missions. So provide some guidance and thought leadership on how users and companies, you know, building the applications can use and use Qt as a technology. So much for, you know, our strategy. Let's go a little bit over and get a bit more concrete. There's basically two main ways of using Qt as a technology out there. There's, you know, the application development side where people, you know, go and build applications for existing platforms, operating systems. This is usually, you know, what you do on desktop or mobile. You know, you do a desktop application or you do a mobile application, and there you can basically use Qt and you deploy it to an existing operating system. The other use case is to create devices, where basically Qt becomes, you know, the integral or the central part of what you do to create your device, where you put this together with a, you know, lean stack underneath, and, you know, either Linux, you know, you could also use QNX or VxWorks or other operating systems, and then, you know, bring, you know, your application and you pull it all together into one stack that you deploy and ship together with your device. But let's start on looking a little bit on the application development side. This is where we've traditionally been, you know, coming from. You know, Qt, the first releases of Qt were on the desktop operating systems. And, you know, here our focus is really on quality, you know, make it really polished, on reliability, and on feature parity between the different platforms. Make sure that all the features work the same way on all the different platforms and operating systems that we support. Um, which also means that, you know, for our upcoming release, like Qt 5.6, a big part of the work that we're doing here is really on polishing, on bug fixing, on quality improvements. Better performance, lesser memory consumptions, and, you know, better compliance with also new operating system releases. The current focus that we had there was for 5.6 was support for high resolution screens. They're coming more and more, you know, Mac OS already has them, the Retina screens. More and more Windows laptops are also coming with very high resolution screens, and we want to make sure that we support these really well. Then we have, you know, the latest Mac OS release, make sure that that one works, and as a big item for us this year, Windows 10, which was the biggest operating system release that came out this year. So let's have a look at Windows 10. Windows 10 actually does something that, you know, only Qt has been doing before, and it tries to bridge, you know, and provide the same operating system for desktop, you know, tablets and mobile devices, something that we've been doing. You know, we have been providing the same API also, you know, across all these different types of devices. So they're doing something a little bit similar. And of course, we support Windows 10 now. And we make it very easy for you. If you've been using Qt before, you know, you can very easily get also your application running on Windows 10. As you might know, Microsoft is changing their APIs, you know, from the old Win32 APIs over to WinRT APIs. And if you want to get an application into the Microsoft Store, you have to use the WinRT APIs. That, you know, for most people means, you know, rewriting the application. If you've been using Qt before, it's actually pretty trivial. We've done the porting work. You know, you just have to basically take your application, recompile it for WinRT, and off you go. You have everything there. So we make it trivial to migrate from the Win32 API world to the WinRT world. And of course, Qt continues to support both API sets from Microsoft. For quite a few years now, we have had a strong focus also on the mobile side and mobile development. You know, it's a pretty natural thing, you know, given what has happened in the years and how, you know, things have developed on the mobile side. The mobile ports and the mobile versions, so Android, iOS, and Windows Phone, still play a very important role in our strategy based on the needs of what people need for multi-screen development. Applications that go and you know, can reach out to the different, can be deployed on the different operating systems from one single code base. We want to make sure that we deliver on a promise that we can, you know, that you can bring a Qt-based application to every major operating system in the world that really matters. So for that, it's really important for us to have well-working mobile ports, and we're going to continue to make sure that they work as well as our desktop versions and our embedded versions. For now, with Qt 5.6, they're pretty much there, they're in shape, they're working very well, and, you know, most of the focus there is now on keeping them working and maintained and polished as we do for the desktop platforms. But there's one thing that actually has happened, you know, with the mobile ports, and that has helped us a lot. It helped us to focus, you know, with Qt on, you know, bringing our resource consumption down. And it helped, and the mobile phones have done something to our users. They have introduced touch-based user interfaces now quite a few years ago, and they've completely changed the expectations of, you know, consumers in how they use computers. Mobile phones are nothing else but computers these days. And they have a touch-based user interface where you can really, you know, manipulate things with your fingers. This is how people nowadays expect, you know, any computer, any device to work. And that, you know, paradigm now is being brought over also into the embedded world, where people, you know, when you do an embedded device and it has a screen, you know, people expect it to be a touch screen, and they expect it to expect a fluid, you know, user experience where they can touch things and manipulate things with their fingers. And we've been preparing with that, with the mobile port, a lot. We've done the enablers with, you know, created the Qt Quick technology to make that possible. And this really is now something that helps us a lot, you know, when we go over and also, you know, look at our embedded story with Qt for device creation. We've actually had some solutions there for device creation for embedded devices for many years. You know, the first version, Qt Embedded, I think we released in 2000, so 15 years ago. But we've done a lot of work since then. And, you know, currently, you know, Qt, the embedded version, is used in many, many different devices. And, you know, used in consumer electronics, in cars, in medical devices like infusion pumps, surgical robots, or, you know, whole industry automation lines. And all of that has been possible because, you know, Qt has a good, you know, basis, a good foundation, a horizontal foundation which enables all of these things. And, you know, the technology to do, you know, touch-based user interfaces. But as we are now moving forward into the future, we also see that there will be a need to, you know, focus on certain, you know, industry verticals. One of the major ones for us will be the automotive industry. So we will be doing some work and focus on that one. But, you know, the good thing about that one is that a lot of the functionality that we will be developing in that context, we plan to bring back into the horizontal offering and make available to everybody. So we will have things that, you know, help us there, you know, push the limits of what you can do with Qt. As an example now with Qt 5.6, we're, for example, introducing a new serial bus API, which supports the automotive CAN bus. And we're doing some work, you know, to have speech recognition enablers in Qt. So lots of these things will, you know, start off with a vertical offering, but then be brought back into the horizontal offering that we have. Another big thing that we're currently doing is actually that we see that Qt is more and more being used as a platform, not only as a UI framework for creating user interfaces or for creating applications, but as a full platform. And we want to really, you know, help people there, you know, and bring in all the things that you need to, you know, create, you know, a full device, you know, the software for a whole device. So we're now, and we want to do that in a good and open way. So we are now, if we look at, for example, Linux, a Linux-based stack, we are working now in the open. We want to, you know, work together with, for example, the Yocto project, and we're doing that to create, you know, a good stack. And we are creating additional tooling on top of that that help you and make it easy for you to create a Linux, full Linux-based stack, create the platform that you need to create, to develop your applications. Another item that we have been working there that really helps you do that platform is that we've been working on what we call the Qt Compositor or Qt Wayland Compositor, where we're using Wayland as the underlying windowing system, and the compositor allows you to create, you know, that UI server that allows you to run multiple applications, and you can create that one using actually Qt Quick as a technology, making it very easy to create the technology, create, you know, the look and feel that you want and still have a good multi-process environment on, which is really needed on more complex embedded systems and devices. And finally, we also want to facilitate and make it easier to go through the whole development life cycle, you know, from the design phase all the way to the maintenance phase. And one of the items that we see there a lot on the embedded side, one of the needs that people have is a good, you know, over-the-air update solution. More and more of the embedded devices that you are creating are now connected devices. They're connected to the internet, which brings a whole lot of new concerns up, you know. What about, you know, security? What about, you know, upgradability of the devices? Because somebody might discover a security issue or another, or bug fixing. How can I upgrade the device? How can I do that? And an over-the-air solution is the solution that you can have when you have a connected device. And we want to provide that solution for you so that it really gets very easy for you to maintain your device and maintain the software for your devices over time. Talking about the Internet of Things, we are also looking more into these areas. I mean, traditionally, Qt has, you know, been, you know, used on the right-hand side on the desktop, And we're slowly now moving, we've been moving over mobile devices and embedded hardware, and we're slowly trying to also move more towards the low end of devices, thinking about smart sensors, small, very small embedded devices, low, you know, with little memory, rather, you know, limited hardware capabilities. And there's two things we want to do there. One of them is make sure that we integrate with all, you know, the protocols that are being used by smart sensors and in IoT types of devices. But the second piece is also that we will be doing now in the next year some work to see how we can basically, you know, get Qt down in terms of size and memory footprint, how you can configure Qt in a way that you can still use it as an enablement technology, as the base fundamental technology that you can put into your IoT type of device. Then we're doing a lot of work on the tooling side. Qt Creator is our main IDE, and we're seeing, you know, that it's actually becoming, you know, more and more used by our users. More and more of our users are using Qt Creator as their main IDE. And even outside of the pure Qt ecosystem, you know, in the wider C++ community, there's quite a lot of people using Qt Creator as their main IDE to do C++ only projects, because it's one of the best C++ IDEs that currently exists out there. And probably, you know, the only one that's really good for C++ development that's cross-platform. But, you know, what we're going to do here for the device creation, you know, for embedded devices, is that we're going to do more and more work. I'm still seeing, you know, when I look at lots of people, how they work with embedded devices, that it's actually difficult to create embedded devices. People are struggling, and, you know, a lot of that is because the tooling is not good enough yet. We want to make sure that the tooling gets so good that, you know, creating an embedded device gets, let's say, almost as easy as writing a desktop application. That's our goal. We want to make sure that, you know, you can very easily pull together your stack for the embedded device. We've already done some steps there with our, you know, Yocto-based tooling. But we also want to make sure that you can, with a single click, deploy your application to the device, with a single click, reflash the device, run the application or your stack on the device, do debugging and profiling on the devices, and all of that should go very seamlessly. In addition, we want to make sure that we can also work, that you can also work closer with designers. As said, I mean, the UI paradigms have changed. You know, the expectations from end users towards the user interfaces are much higher now than they used to be a couple of years ago. So you need to work with UI designers, and we want to make sure we can more easily integrate them into the workflow. So we've done some work now over the last year with the Qt Quick Designer to make that more better possible. And we will be doing more work also looking into tools that designers use and how we can integrate them into the development workflow. Another item that's going to be important for us moving forward is user experience creation. We've been, you know, over the years always trying to pioneer there. We've had, you know, the Qt widgets in the early days and with an abstraction that actually made them look native on all the different operating systems. We were the first ones to do that. We've been doing lots of work on 2D painting, OpenGL integration. We've had internationalized text layouts as one of the first frameworks out there. And we've been doing, you know, lots of research in Qt Quick and how we can do touch, how we can make it easy to create touch-based animated fluid user interfaces. What we're currently seeing today is that there's a lot of focus now and a lot of interest in creating 3D user experiences. And we want to make sure that we also there are, you know, on the top of it and are looking now into how can we create, you know, a good and compelling 3D offering that makes it very easy. And we've now been doing two new things over the last year that we've added there. One of them is the Qt Canvas 3D, which is basically something where you can use WebGL together with our Qt Quick technology. And you can easily integrate that. You can use whatever you have from WebGL and know from WebGL, put that into a Qt Quick scene graph and use that very easily there. The other piece is that we're working now on the Qt 3D module. It's also there in Qt 5.6, it's still available as a technology preview. which makes it very easy to integrate full 3D contents, you know, 3D objects into your application and into the Qt Quick-based application. And we also have very good and easy to use integration with multimedia. As you can see here, this is done with Qt 3D, Qt Multimedia, and Qt Quick. The whole example that you see here. We want to make that integration seamless and allow you to really use, you know, 3D, 2D user interfaces as you see fit and the way you want to use them. And finally, a big focus area for us has been, you know, web technologies. Qt has always had, you know, the WebKit integration for many years now, but we've had to redo that one for various reasons, and we now have the Qt Web Engine as the main technology that we want to promote there. Qt Web Engine is based on top of Chromium, and we're really tightly following whatever's happening upstream in Chromium so that we're really on the latest releases with every release of Qt Web Engine, which really gives you a fully HTML5 compliant stack, pretty much the best stack that we could possibly offer you. And it's tightly integrated into Qt, it's tightly integrated into the Qt Quick Scene Graph. So you get really the best of both worlds. You can use the native technologies where you need, you can use HTML, and you can combine them using things like WebSockets and WebChannel. In addition, you know, for the cross-platform offering, we have the Qt Web View, which basically is slightly, you know, simpler API to integrate, you know, web content into your application. It's using Web Engine behind the scenes on some platforms, or the native web rendering engine of the operating system on the platforms where we have to use that, like for example on iOS. So this will be a continuous focus for us now also moving forward. Make sure that we have a very good integration with HTML as a technology. As a summary now for the Qt 5.6 release, this is what we've been doing and the main highlights of the upcoming release. We're getting very close to the beta now, and the main points here is the Windows 10 support. We've added support for the latest Visual Studio compiler. We have made sure that everything works smoothly on the latest macOS release. Then we've been working on, you know, a cross-platform high DPI solution. Make sure that really high DPI screens work seamlessly. We've had a lot of focus on 3D and web. In addition, we added Qt location now, so you have mapping support and support for maps in Qt. And we've added as a new technology preview a lot of new modules. The serial bus I've talked about shortly, with the CAN bus as the first implementation for automotive. Text to speech and speech recognition through the Qt speech APIs. Qt Wayland compositor, and we actually have also a new set of Qt Quick controls for embedded. This is something I haven't been talking about yet, but it's a very nice and cool feature. We have, as you might know, had for some time now, a set of Qt Quick controls. With Qt 5.6, we're introducing a new set that's really focused on the embedded use case. Much more lightweight, faster, slightly different API, but much more suited for the embedded development. So less memory consumption, faster, but, you know, we don't have native styling on the desktop platforms. But I think, you know, for anybody wanting to do embedded devices, that's not going to be a problem anyway. And then there's one final new feature that we have for Qt 5.6, and that's that we're introducing a long-term supported release with it. Qt 5.6 will be supported for 3 years from now on, even while we develop, you know, 5.7, 5.8, and maybe 5.9 in parallel. As you might know, the previous long-term supported release that we had was Qt 4.8, and that's really now nearing, you know, getting to the end of its lifetime. We're going to stop supporting that now by the end of the year. And, you know, to replace that, Qt 5.6 will be the next version that has a long-term support policy from our side. So then, looking a little bit out into the future, what's happening after 5.6 with Qt 5.7? One of the things that we're doing now is actually that we have a bit more freedom. Since 5.6 is a long-term supported release, we can now go in and basically say, okay, we remove some of the oldest compilers, for example, from the list of supported pieces or functionality in 5.7. And we will be requiring a C++11 compliant compiler in Qt 5.7 and onwards, which means, you know, Visual Studio 2010 will not be supported anymore, for example. So we'll be focusing on, you know, making sure that we can really make use of the latest C++11 and maybe also partially C++14 features. We want to make sure that we focus on 3D and have a good offering there, you know, really finalize Qt 3D and make it a really good you know, thing to use there. Serial bus will be something that we will work on and continue to work on, adding some more buses there. Speech recognition, making that final, and the Wayland compositor. In addition, we'll be working and continue to work on the Qt Quick Controls story and see how the new set of embedded controls that have a, you know, better performance, what we want to do with them, how we want to develop them. Finally, we will have some, we're doing now some work on state machines and making sure that we have good state machine support that we all have in Qt, but extend that also have a tooling story around that, with where you can use SCXML, a state machine standard, compile that into Qt code, where you can have graphical tooling around it and everything like that. And have that, of course, integrated into our IDE, into Qt Creator. And then looking forward, as I said, I mean, I already touched a little bit on our roadmap and strategy for today. And let's try to summarize a little bit what the features are now that we'll be focusing on for the future. I think the, you know, C++ and you know, making use of the latest versions of the standard is clearly going to be a focus area. And we want Qt to continue to be the de facto, you know, framework and toolkit for C++ development. And make sure it evolves together with the C++ standards. Then we are looking into really pushing the limits of where, you know, how low you can go in terms of, you know, devices, what kind of low-end devices you can use with Qt. Really push the limits there and make sure that Qt is suitable for as low-end devices as possible. This is also something that will help in general, because whatever we do there in improvements will help, you know, also on more powerful devices, make Qt better to use there. And, you know, of course, you know, when we look at the embedded side, the whole platform thinking will play a bigger role, you know. Make sure that, you know, Qt can be used as the platform that you can use and develop your applications and your devices with. As I said, and, you know, really make sure that our embedded development story becomes as easy and as seamless as what you are expected from, or what you know from desktop or mobile development. Then I think we'll get a lot of new APIs into Qt, and most of those will, you know, evolve from, you know, industry-specific vertical needs, and then we will go and try to make sure that we horizontalize that, bring that into, you know, Qt as a horizontal product back into there. Lots of work on graphics, where we'll look into, you know, the upcoming OpenGL replacement Vulkan, which is now, you know, being developed by Kronos. Make sure we are there, we support it when you need it. And, you know, and there will be, I guess, lots of other final items. So, you know, to summarize, I think, you know, we have seen that over the last 20 years, we've grown, you know, to become, you know, one of the, you know, de facto or leading cross-platform toolkits that people are using to develop applications, to create devices. And of course, we want to continue doing that and continue to be leading that story forward for the next, you know, 20 years to come. Thank you very much.